Welcome to Mr. Brown's Basement, a channel devoted to sharing the craft of repairing, restoring, and modifying vintage electronic gear and other random stuff. Here's my definition of phonograph in 2023 language. In the first three videos on the Bing Crosby Philco 461201, I gave an overview of the radio and record player. Then I disassembled and repaired the radio chassis. And next, I did an alignment of the receiver and addressed various other issues with the radio. In this video, I'm going to repair the record player, which is a Philco M-7 mechanism. First, let's go over what this record player does and how it works. Unlike other 78 RPM record players, this mechanism only has four actions. Two movements, raising and lowering the spindle. Two movements, raising and lowering the tone arm. One movement, returning the tone arm to its home position. And finally, two movements, turning the platter motor on and turning it off. That's it. Many record players use a rotating cam driven by the platter motor to synchronize these actions. This record player has no such cam. Instead, it has levers to manage all the movements. The motor does nothing but spin the platter. The levers are actually unknowingly moved by the user. More on this later.
It looks really filthy on the top, which it is. On the bottom, not too bad. But this is not a beauty contest. This is about getting it to work. Normally, this would have a certain amount of grease on it because things need to move. So I'm going to clean off some of this crud, but then again, I'm going to put grease on afterwards. Looking at the motor here, awful lot of resistance. So I think the motor has to come out, which means the platter also has to come out. I was able to get the platter off just by prying very hard with a screwdriver, and it came straight off. Now this is flocking, it's fuzzy, but the rest of it is where flocking used to be. And I don't know if I can apply new flocking to it. It's ever so slightly fuzzy, but not fuzzy enough to be useful to prevent the record from slipping. All right, here's the idler and the motor spindle and an awful lot of crud. There's the main bearing for the spindle, and it's really dirty. It needs to be cleaned. This whole thing is stationary, but this is not. This is. Let's see if I can remove the motor now. There's a grub screw. And that has come out. The grub screw goes inward. This hook goes underneath that. Pulling out these three screws has loosened the motor, but it still won't come out. Well, I guess then it is these two nuts on the top. These two nuts on the top. When you take the motor out by removing these screws, these three screws, it literally comes apart in your hands. These standoffs, and notice there are two here and two here, they fall out. And the rotor wants to come out too. Now, as I suspected, this rotor is gummy, which means that the bearings or whatever is in there, the sleeve and whatever is in here, will also be gummy. I have to take off this clip here, and then I can clean and lubricate inside. I don't think it's going to turn like this. I'm actually using a lot of force to turn it, and it's not happy to turn. And these motors are not exactly high torque, so it's not going to turn like that. This is what I have to remove to get to the sleeve at the bottom end of the motor. So there's a clip, a washer, a fan, a felt washer, a big washer, a small washer, and another clip. And they go on in order. Yes, it's a sleeve. And the sleeve needs to be cleaned and lubricated, cleaned with alcohol, and then lubricated with a little bit of grease. The same thing with the shaft. The other end doesn't look like it's going to come off. I could be mistaken, but I don't think so. In that case, I'll have to clean and lubricate as best I can. I'm ready to test the motor. If you do something like this, you have to be really awake, because there will be 110 volts here, and that's a good way of getting a bad shock. Well, the motor's moving, which is great. It looks like it's moving slowly, but that's because there's a stroboscopic effect with the overhead light and with my camera. It's actually moving very quickly. Before I reattach the idler assembly, I need to clean it up, it's filthy, and lubricate underneath, because this needs to move like that. The tire, which is this piece of rubber on the outside of the wheel, is very luckily in good condition. So it will grip the underside of the platter. The spindle has a sea washer on it, but it's not coming off for me. And if it doesn't come off, then I don't want to force it because it may be destructive. So I've lubricated it as best I can. It's not as smooth as I'd like it to be. It feels a bit viscous, but it is turning. So I'm going to leave it and see if the motor will actually drive it now that the friction in the motor and everything else between it and the spindle has been reduced. I think the answer for the platter is to sand it down, which is what I've done. Taken off all the flocking that was left, because it's sort of fuzzy and things won't stick to it. Then I'm going to paint it with rust paint, like Tremclad or whatever I have. And then I'm going to stick on this stuff, which is fuzzy on one side and adhesive on the other. And we'll see how it looks. In the meantime, the first part of the drivetrain is working. There you have it. It's been painted. That'll give it a nice, even finish that the adhesive is more likely to stick to. And I've just used brown rust paint. What holds the record in place when the record is inserted is the spindle. And the spindle has to rise when the door is closed. And I don't think mine wants to. It looks like it's rusted in. It's not going anywhere. I'm going to lubricate it and see if I can get it to move. A little bit of oil and a sharp knock with the pliers. And guess what? It moves as it should. It's normally down. When you insert the record, it moves into position. The record plays. And then when you open it up, this allows you to remove it. Here's the platter with the self-adhesive flock paper, or fuzzy paper, applied. It doesn't look too bad. I guess the hardest part was getting the hole in the middle, but I got it.
Underneath the soundboard, there's a mercury switch concealed in a cardboard tube. When it's angled one way, the motor is energized, and when it's angled the other, the motor is off. Yes, it really does contain a gob of mercury.
When testing this thing out, if the soundboard, this thing here, is not in the right position, the mercury switch might be on or off, which is not exactly what you want at that time. I may end up mounting it on its original base and try to test it with it sort of leaning over the edge of the workbench so I can keep an eye on what's going on underneath. These guides were originally made as service parts, so there was a brass insert with a rubber jacket on the outside.
Not surprisingly, they're no longer available.
My solution is to use plastic pipe, which I'm going to slide down over it, like so. And that will not be quite as kind as rubber, but will be better than nothing. The motor board, this thing, rests on these mounts, which are disintegrating. The idea was to reduce the vibration and make it less likely that the tone arm would skip on the record. I'm sure there's somebody who manufactures these, probably way too expensive. So I'll see what I can do to improvise. My solution is to take that metal piece out, get some of these washers from the hardware store, they're plumbing washers, ream them out so they're a little bigger inside, but still snug, and stick them on. And maybe they're not quite as rubbery as the originals, but they're solution.
There are the improvised rubber mounts in place.
The soundboard has been reattached to the base. Before I lubricate any of this stuff, or this stuff here, I want to attach some wires with disconnects on them, so that in the future, if it needs to be serviced again, it won't be a chore to desolder these wires. That's very poor design. They should have had disconnects, even an RCA plug on that. They didn't do anything. It was all soldered. Not going to be that way anymore.
This arm has to be in the right place so that as the mechanism resets when the drawer is opened, it hits the trip pawl to turn the power off. The adjustment screw is where the tone arm trip lever attaches to the tone arm. Mine was quite far out of adjustment.
What should happen is we should open up the door, the spindle retracts, and the arm rises. Then we slide in our record, which moves out the guides, and like so. And then we shut the door, lowering the tone arm onto the record. It really lowered, and the mechanism is captive. And it plays and plays and plays and plays and plays until it reaches the end. I don't think my spindle has come up, but I have to check that. And then we open it and lifts the tone arm and resets the mechanism. That's how it's supposed to work. The problem I'm having is this spring, which rides in this slot. This controls the height of the spindle. And what's happening is, when the door is opened, I'll open it. Instead of returning to the slot as it should, riding this up into the slot, it gets stuck right over there, and then the spindle doesn't retract and rise as it should. I think this may be worn. No amount of adjusting seems to make any difference. I'm going to assume that the keyhole is worn. I don't need to get it to sit in the keyhole entirely. In that position, the spindle is up as far as it can go. It doesn't need to go anywhere. I've taken a small piece of plastic, and with some silicone, I've affixed it. It'll have to stay overnight, and then we'll see. There's not going to be a lot of stress on it, and certainly not very often. There's a fair amount of surface area, so we will see how that works tomorrow. This has been allowed to dry overnight. Let's see how it does. So the spindle's up as it should be. I lower the door, the spindle retracts, and the arm goes up. Now I'll simulate putting in a record, which pulls the guides apart. And with the invisible record in, I close the door, spindle goes up, the arm goes down on the side of the record. The record plays and plays and plays and plays and plays. I open up the door, mechanism resets.
Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Wile E. Coyote. Genius.
Mechanically, it seems to be okay. The only issue may be, number one, whether it lends on the record, that's an adjustment, and whether the cartridge is any good, which it probably isn't, because crystal cartridges go bad with moisture, with heat, with time, or even looking at them the wrong way. Let's try it with power, then with a record. The mercury switch is no good. Here's my solution. Here's the cylinder from a paper capacitor.
Here's a float switch.
It's a reed switch with a magnet around it. I'm going to embed this in this and attach it to that.
Here goes with a new float switch used as a tilt switch.
I open the door, I simulate the record being put in, I close the door, the record plays and plays and plays until it reaches the middle, and then I open the door, and it's off.
Genius!
Have brain, eh? Hey, that must be very handy at times.
The only thing which is weird, and that's, I guess, Philco's design, is when this is closed, the turntable's on. And this probably isn't quite in the right place. Here goes with the Who's Here Hot Shots. I guess Drake is not available on this in vinyl on shellac. Slide it in, reaches the end of a 10 inch. And it would be playing. I've connected the output to some speakers, and I'm fairly certain that the cartridge is dead. You can listen for yourself. Well, unless I can fit another cartridge in there, and I'm in no hurry to do that, I would say this record player part of the Philco 461201 is working.
I hope you enjoyed this video from Mr. Brown's Basement. Please like and subscribe to see more videos, including my final video in the series showing the repair and restoration of the Philco 461201's cabinet.